From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to the JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. Thanks for being here. I'm Dr. David Simel, JAMA Associate Editor and Professor Emeritus of Medicine at the Durham Veterans Affairs Medical Center and Duke University. In this podcast, we will be discussing adrenal insufficiency. I'm joined today by Dr. Anand Vaidya, who is an Associate Professor of Medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital, Harvard Medical School, and the Director of their Center for Adrenal Disorders. Dr. Vaidya is the lead author of our narrative review on adrenal insufficiency in the June 16th, 2025 edition of JAMA. Dr. Vaidya, thank you for joining us today.
It's great to be here. Thank you, David.
Well, let's get started. Adrenal insufficiency is primarily cortisol deficiency, and cortisol levels in a healthy person are higher in the morning, lower in the afternoon, but they also help us respond to stress. When we say stress, what kind of stress are we talking about?
So that's a great question. You know, David, cortisol does a lot of things. It's a hormone that has so many actions that we can't really list them all. But one way to think about it is many of its actions are catabolic. So cortisol regulates the metabolism of tissue substrates so that they become available to the rest of the body. So for example, cortisol regulates glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. So it's mobilizing glucose into the circulation. It increases lipolysis and proteolysis, meaning it's breaking down fat and muscles so that the body has fuel, has substrates for metabolism, and so on. So clinically speaking, cortisol regulates glycemic control by preventing hypoglycemia. It regulates blood pressure by direct and indirect pressor effects. So when a patient is faced with stressors like low blood pressure or low blood glucose or major illnesses that require some sort of systemic inflammatory response like fever, like sepsis, even severe pain, cortisol is released and plays an important homeostatic role.
Patients with adrenal insufficiency might present to us in the clinic or in the emergency department, or they might be severely ill in an intensive care unit. Tell us about the clinical symptoms and signs of adrenal insufficiency in those various settings.
Yes, that's right. So the signs and symptoms of cortisol insufficiency or deficiency can be fairly nonspecific and broad. And as you kind of described, they can include just about anything. The most common symptoms of adrenal insufficiency are nausea, fatigue, weakness, anorexia, and even kind of diffuse body and joint pains. But there are some signs and symptoms that are pretty specific. So for example, if a patient has hyponatremia and unexplained hyperkalemia, that should immediately trigger thoughts of adrenal insufficiency. If a patient has unexplained hyperpigmentation in the context of other symptoms that are concerning for adrenal insufficiency, this is a sign of high ACTH levels, and again, is fairly specific for adrenal insufficiency. And then intense salt cravings or low blood pressure that's unexplained or orthostatic symptoms, these are also symptoms that warrant consideration for adrenal insufficiency. And so there are a lot of nonspecific symptoms, but there are some fairly specific symptoms that tend to occur a little bit later in the progress of adrenal insufficiency.
You mentioned hyperpigmentation being caused by a high level of ACTH or adrenocorticotropic hormone. Why does that cause hyperpigmentation?
Yes. You know, if you go up the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, we start in the hypothalamus. And the hypothalamus secretes a protein called CRH, corticotropin releasing hormone. It travels just a few millimeters to the pituitary, and it increases expression of a large protein, pro-opiomelanocortin, POMC, which is then cleaved. This large protein is cleaved into tiny little SNPs. And of those little tiny cleaved proteins and peptides are adrenocorticotropic hormone, ACTH, which goes to the adrenal gland and tells the adrenal to make cortisol, MSH, melanocyte-stimulating hormone, and a bunch of endorphins and enkephalins that are kind of our body's endogenous opioids. And melanocyte-stimulating hormone and adrenocorticotropic hormone have quite a lot of homology. So the same hormone, melanocyte-stimulating hormone, that stimulates our melanocytes to increase and cause darkening of our skin or tanning can be stimulated by ACTH. So when you have high ACTH levels, as in primary adrenal insufficiency, one of the manifestations in some, sometimes even the majority of patients, is hyperpigmentation, diffuse tanning, even in non-sun exposed regions.
Let's discuss a patient in the clinic where we're considering the diagnosis of adrenal insufficiency. How do you go about testing the patient for that?
There's a lot of different ways to test for adrenal insufficiency, but my advice, and I guess what I'll discuss here for clinicians, is to start with the simplest and most pragmatic approach, which would be to ask your patient to go to the laboratory first thing in the morning when it opens, 7:30, 8 a.m., and have a serum cortisol, ACTH, and DHEAS measured. So this is just a simple venipuncture first thing in the morning. And the reason I recommend this is what we're trying to do is evaluate whether cortisol production is normal. And so what is normal cortisol production? Cortisol observes a diurnal rhythm. So it peaks first thing in the morning, really timed to sunrise or awakening. And thus, by asking your patient to get to the lab first thing in the morning, around 8 a.m. or whenever the lab first opens, we're really testing to see whether the body makes enough cortisol. And you can immediately see from this description that this is not an exact science. For example, I may wake up at 4 a.m. and go running. And so if I got to the lab at 8 a.m., I might have missed my cortisol peak by a few hours. Whereas another person might wake up at 10 a.m. every morning. So asking them to wake up and go to the lab at 8 might be missing the peak on the early side. So this is an inexact science. And for that reason, the interpretations of the labs are not exact, but rather probabilistic. Of course, the higher the cortisol, the more reassuring the results. But generally speaking, a morning cortisol that's about 10 micrograms per deciliter or higher is pretty reassuring that the patient's symptoms are very unlikely to be due to adrenal insufficiency. On the other hand, if you have a patient who you're concerned about or you think about adrenal insufficiency, you send them to the lab in the morning and their morning cortisol is below 5 micrograms per deciliter, this is highly concerning for adrenal insufficiency. And lab values that fall in between, kind of in that 5 to 10 microgram per deciliter range, are either concerning for some degree of adrenal insufficiency or kind of an inexact number due to poor timing or other reasons. And in these cases, you can do a couple of things. You can ask your patient to repeat the lab on another morning where the results might be more informative. You can look at other values that are obtained. I'll talk about the ACTH and DHEAS values in a moment. Or you can consider doing a more dynamic or kind of laborious test, like an ACTH stimulation test, which I can also talk about if you'd like. So you interpret the cortisol values, and as I mentioned, you're also going to measure DHEAS and ACTH. So why are you doing that? So DHEAS is an adrenal androgen, and it is also produced by the adrenal cortex in response to ACTH. So both cortisol and DHEAS are biomarkers of ACTH action on the adrenal gland. If you don't make ACTH, you don't make cortisol or DHEAS. Every form of adrenal insufficiency will have a low cortisol and a low or low normal DHEAS level, either because the adrenal cortex can't make steroids or because there's an insufficiency or deficiency of ACTH. So the DHEAS value gives you another metric or biomarker to evaluate for adrenal insufficiency in addition to cortisol. And finally, if you obtained an ACTH level, that can also be helpful because if your suspicion was correct, and your patient's cortisol is low and concerning for adrenal insufficiency, then having a high ACTH level, typically twice the upper limit of the reference range or 100 picograms per milliliter or higher, points towards primary adrenal insufficiency, whereas a low or low normal ACTH level steers you towards secondary adrenal insufficiency, such as a pituitary issue or glucocorticoid-induced adrenal insufficiency.
So there are three tests. There's the cortisol level, there's the ACTH, and there is the DHEA level. And a general internist can order all of those tests. What is DHEA?
DHEA is an androgen made by the adrenal cortex, specifically in the zona reticularis. Once it's secreted, it's sulfated to DHEAS, and it has a pretty stable and long half-life. It doesn't have the pulsatility that cortisol has, and it's actually secreted in the highest abundance by the adrenal gland. So it's present in higher volumes than cortisol and in a kind of a more stable way. So it serves as a pretty consistent biomarker of ACTH activity and parallels cortisol production.
Aldosterone wasn't part of your algorithm there.
That's right. So it's a good question because aldosterone deficiency can also be a part or a manifestation of the adrenal insufficiency syndrome. However, adrenal insufficiency is universally defined by cortisol deficiency. So that's the hormone we care most about. And it's the deficiency of cortisol that causes the majority of symptoms and life-threatening events, if not diagnosed. One form of adrenal insufficiency, that is primary adrenal insufficiency, or sometimes called Addison's disease, also can present with aldosterone deficiency. And so once you've kind of triangulated that your patient has adrenal insufficiency that is primary or Addison's disease, then you can consider evaluating aldosterone. But what I would suggest is if your patient has primary adrenal insufficiency or Addison's disease, you should seek the help or counsel of an endocrinologist, because all of those patients should be managed by a specialist like an endocrinologist.
Well, let's talk about the management. And specifically, let's first talk about the outpatient who has cortisol deficiency, who's not acutely ill, but has the low cortisol levels. How do you go about replacing the cortisol?
Yeah, so all patients with adrenal insufficiency have a cortisol deficiency and therefore require treatment with glucocorticoids. Patients with primary adrenal insufficiency, as I just mentioned, will also require treatment with a mineralocorticoid. And the goal here is to give physiologic glucocorticoid treatment to kind of mimic or recapitulate or supplement the missing cortisol amounts. And there's no perfect way to do this. So the idea is to use the lowest dose possible of the glucocorticoid to help your patient achieve a good quality of life. This is typically around 15 to 25 milligrams of hydrocortisone total for the day, or 3 to 5 milligrams of prednisone or prednisolone per day. The hydrocortisone is usually given as a split dose, once first thing in the morning and once in the early afternoon, with the morning dose representing about 2/3 of the total daily dose. And prednisone or prednisolone can be given once a day, first thing in the morning.
These are given as oral medications.
Yes, oral medications.
So you alluded to primary adrenal insufficiency. What about secondary adrenal insufficiency or glucocorticoid-induced adrenal insufficiency? How do you go about treating those patients?
So secondary adrenal insufficiency refers to a disorder or pathology that has happened to the pituitary gland such that it is incapable of making ACTH. And in the absence of ACTH, the adrenal glands don't get the signal to make cortisol. So the key defining factor of secondary adrenal insufficiency, it's a cortisol deficiency. Aldosterone production continues normally because angiotensin II and serum potassium will continue to stimulate aldosterone production. So these patients have an isolated cortisol deficiency. Similarly, patients with glucocorticoid-induced adrenal insufficiency, which is to say iatrogenic adrenal insufficiency caused by healthcare providers who prescribe high doses of glucocorticoids for other reasons, will also cause an isolated ACTH deficiency. So both of these forms of adrenal insufficiency require treatment with glucocorticoids in the same physiologic doses that I mentioned earlier, something like 3 to 5 milligrams of prednisone or prednisolone per day, and approximately 15 to 25 milligrams of hydrocortisone total per day orally.
For the patient with glucocorticoid-induced adrenal insufficiency who's about to undergo surgery, what do we do for those patients?
Yeah, so this is a good question. If somebody has adrenal insufficiency, so they're not able to mount a cortisol response, and their body's going to sustain some sort of major physical stressor, and sometimes even emotional or intense emotional or mental stressors, their body's going to need more cortisol. So if you or I were to undergo a surgery or were to have a serious febrile illness, COVID, flu, etc., our body would probably make more cortisol. How much more? It's really hard to say because our body knows what it needs, but it might double or triple its endogenous production. A patient who is dependent on glucocorticoids to replace their physiologic cortisol production will need to increase their dose to match the stressor. And so there's no way for us as physicians or healthcare providers to know what the mismatch between their physiologic glucocorticoid dose and their stressed cortisol requirement is. We kind of have to guesstimate that. So for most stressors, a febrile illness that someone might encounter, like a flu, a painful injury, we typically recommend double or triple the dose for a couple of days until the illness has subsided. For something like a surgery, you need to ask some more questions. You know, is this a major surgery that's going to require general anesthesia? If so, we will talk to the patient, their provider, and even sometimes the anesthesia team and let them know this patient has adrenal insufficiency. They're dependent on glucocorticoids. Therefore, at the time of anesthesia and before the surgery starts, they require a stress dose of intravenous glucocorticoid, typically 100 milligrams of IV hydrocortisone. And then what happens after that depends on the severity of the surgery, the duration that the patient is expected to be, say, intubated or in recovery. And if the instructions are not easy, we would advise that the hospital team consult the inpatient endocrine service to help follow that patient. And in this review, we actually have a table that has many recommendations for common stressors that patients might encounter, from febrile illnesses to surgeries to colonoscopies and the general advisable stress dose. But there's always some customization required if you veer beyond those general recommendations.
Well, let's shift our focus to the patient who is acutely ill in the emergency room, let's say with hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, and maybe shock. How does our diagnostic and management approach change for that patient?
So you're describing a patient who sounds like they're having an adrenal crisis. They're in hypotension, they're in shock, and then you also have described some other clues, hyponatremia and hyperkalemia. So there are many causes of shock, but if you saw hyponatremia and hyperkalemia with that, you might think that this person had undiagnosed adrenal insufficiency and is now in an adrenal crisis. There's no universal definition of an adrenal crisis, but generally it's described as a life-threatening cortisol deficiency in the context of some major illness or stressor presenting with hypotension, shock, or altered mental status. So these patients require immediate supraphysiologic glucocorticoid therapy. In this case, it would be intravenous large hydrocortisone bolus, like 100 milligrams, followed by boluses of 50 to 100 milligrams of hydrocortisone every 4 to 6 hours, or a continuous intravenous infusion. In addition, they would need fluid resuscitation to counter the shock, and then attention to whatever the underlying cause that triggered the crisis might be, whether it's an infection or other illness.
How quickly will that patient respond to cortisol replacement?
That's a difficult question to answer. I mean, the good thing about giving an intravenous hydrocortisone bolus is the patient's endogenous glucocorticoid receptors are going to start seeing it right away. But if they're very hypotensive and they have a distributive shock, they might respond differently than if they have a hypovolemic shock. So there's other factors that need to be done at the same time, fluid resuscitation and addressing the underlying thing. So if they have sepsis due to some infectious source, that's also going to need to be addressed. But generally speaking, if the only issue was that the patient needed a little bit more cortisol and wasn't getting it in time, they're going to turn around pretty quickly. In an emergency room, 1 or 2 liters of fluids after 100 milligrams of hydrocortisone, we can get patients discharged within a couple of hours. But this just depends on how soon they're treated and how sick they are.
Well, is there anything else you would like our listeners to know about adrenal insufficiency?
And what I would emphasize, you know, assuming the listeners here are largely general clinicians, is one, keep it simple. If you suspect adrenal insufficiency, you don't have to be fancy or do stimulation tests or refer. Ask your patient to get a morning cortisol, ACTH, and DHEAS. These values will likely give you the answer you need.
Well, thank you, Dr. Vadia, for joining us today to talk about adrenal insufficiency. I am Dr. David Simel. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. You can find a link to this manuscript in the episode show notes. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.